Hi, everyone. Welcome to City Church Rockford. As you give today, remember there are multiple ways you can give. Drop it in the buckets as they're passed, give online on our website or app, put it in the boxes by the doors as you exit, or mail into the church. One of our pillars of ministry here is knowing and living out the Word of God, and we have seen that happen so powerfully as we join with like-minded brothers and sisters in the context of our men's and women's ministries. And both of our men's and women's spring studies will be starting soon. City Church men are starting a study called Dangerous Prayers, which kicks off tomorrow, April 15th at 6:30 p.m. In this study, you will learn to unlock your greatest potential and tackle your greatest fears by praying stronger, more passionate prayers that lead you into a deeper faith. City Church women will have studies on Tuesday nights and Thursday mornings starting this week on April 16th and 18th. The Tuesday night study is Behold and Believe, which digs deep into the fullness of all that Jesus meant in his seven I Am statements in the book of John. Thursday morning has two different studies, Married Life and Choose Joy. Through the Married Life study, you will learn to cultivate a thriving, Christ-centered marriage. And in Choose Joy, you will learn to experience soul-satisfying joy no matter what you're going through. You can learn more about any of these studies at the tables in the lobby. Registrations for all the men's and women's studies are now open, so you can get signed up today on our app or website. One of our pillars here at City Church is NextGen. And one way that we live that out is by partnering with parents in raising their children and dedicating them to the Lord. Child dedication is a way to acknowledge that as a parent, you are committing to raising your kids according to the Word of God. And as a church, we are committed to supporting parents in this task. Our next child dedication is coming up on May 12th. And if you have a child you would like to dedicate, you can register right now on our app or website. There are so many great things happening here at City Church. Head to our app or website for all the details of everything going on. If there's anything else we can help you with, please go to one of the welcome centers in the lobby.
Good morning, City Church. Y'all can stand up to your feet. I lost my voice this morning, so y'all are gonna have to help me out. You ready?
I'll praise in the valley, and I'll praise on the mountain. I'll praise when I'm sore, and praise when I'm doubting. I'll praise when I'm outnumbered, I'll praise when I'm surrounded. As long as
all of our praise. There is no one like you. Come on, sing this. Behold the Lamb.
Behold the Lamb upon the cross, who takes away the sins of all. Forgiveness flows from hands and feet as violence meets the Prince of.
church with your people all over this nation today. We're so grateful. All the ruins of religion and empire over the centuries have all fallen, and their leaders are dead in the grave, but not you. You're seated at God's right hand as our representative, the only mediator, the God-man, risen from the dead, preparing a place for us, and we're part of your body, your representation here on earth. And Lord, we thank you for this exalted, awesome place you've given us. And while you prepare a place for us, you said, occupy till I come back. And so, Lord, we do that as salt and light in this broken, hurting world. God, we pray for your kingdom purposes. Lord, we thank you for protecting Israel during this horrific attack in the last couple days. Lord, just thank you that your word, Psalm 121, says, he that keeps Israel neither slumbers nor sleeps. And Lord, you said you are also our keeper and our shade on your right hand because we're your body. Lord, we thank you for the security of knowing you. And Lord, we pray that your kingdom will come, your will be done. Lord, we pray for our relationship with the United States and Israel. God, protect that relationship in spite of everything anyone plans. Lord, keep us connected to your purposes for the nations, for the gospel, for the world. And Lord, we pray for this community. Shed your grace. Lord, move powerfully by your Spirit. Kurt, let's sing and proclaim this. Presence of God in this place. Turn around, greet your neighbor, make some noise, introduce yourself. If you're visiting for the first time today, we welcome you. Hope you have an awesome time worshiping with us. Welcome to our online audience as well. Hope you have an awesome time visiting and worshiping with us today as well. If you are visiting for the first time, in your seat pocket in front of you is a Connect card. Please pull it out, fill it out. We have a free gift for you. We're giving away free Yeti-style mugs and hoodies and stuff worth something. It's good stuff. If you're a first-time visitor, also we ask that you give us, it's not mandatory, but give us 3 weeks of your attendance here if you don't have a home church, and just see whether you can't find a home here and we can be a blessing and an impact on your life. So that's awesome. By the way, if you're techie, just hit the QR code on the screen. It'll take you to our website and do the same thing. I'm really excited about everything that's going on today as we get ready to take. I'm so excited about what I'm going to say next that I didn't even offer to pray over the offering or anything the last two services. I never even announced we were going to take an offering. I hope somebody gave something. And here I am. It's a pitch about us throwing down financially, and I didn't even take the offering or pray for it, but so it all rests on you. No, but either way, I'm really excited about something going on. By the way, men's and women, sign up in the lobby for the studies. It's awesome. Dangerous Prayers, the men are studying. Guys, you won't want to miss this. It's going to be a risky, exciting Bible study, and there are dangerous prayers you can pray. I'll just give you one. God, do with me whatever you want. I prayed that prayer. either way, you're going to really, really enjoy that. Today also, I want to talk to you about our newest mission project. and it's called the All In Project. We did it before when we built a complete addition on this place for $4.5 million. And we raised all the money here. We're debt free here today, and which is just awesome. We are going to do another All In Project, and it's the Greenville church plant has blown up so bad. It's good, so good. Easter Sunday, they had 624 people. I want to show you a video about a project that's already in place. The leadership board, the officers, everybody are all in behind this thing. And it's a powerful, powerful project because it's mission. It involves a building, but it's all missions as we try to create a bastion of grace and light in these entire four communities around here that actually will protect us in time to come, bring security and the grace of God into this region so it glows far beyond this place. You know, and what we've done is we started at the ends of the earth and now we're end up in our backyard. But every healthy church has a translocal vision. It says Jerusalem, Judea, Samaria, and the uttermost parts of the earth. Well, guess what? Judea was 19.5 miles from downtown Jerusalem, and Greenville, Michigan is 19.5 miles from down. So I've nicknamed this project Judea. We are going to go after something in our backyard, and it will reap inestimable fruit. Watch this video. Over 20 years ago, when my wife and I came up to Rockford, Michigan to plant a church here, we came up with a leading to transform communities, and that's our passion. A few years ago, when we grew to a significant size, I knew it was time to move to other communities. And Pastor Tim and Marcy Simon, who had been with us for many years, live in Greenville, and I always knew we would be doing something with them.
In 2019, we launched the church in Greenville, and right away we knew we wanted to be a blessing to the community. Greenville is 30% larger than Rockford, so there's so many people that we felt like they just needed the gospel, needed the Holy Spirit. We were in different communities and different neighborhoods in Greenville, fixing houses, doing whatever we could, food deliveries, and instantly we started to see the impact in the community and just the hunger in that community for the Holy Spirit. And God was moving. Our services started growing, and today we've seen over 700 salvations, 300 baptisms. It's cool to see what God has done in such a short time, but we know He's got so much more in store for us. Currently, we're meeting at the Flat River Academy, and we are growing. And I think people keep asking, when are we gonna have a place of our own? And this is the time. This is the time to rise and build a place of our own. We were able to purchase 4 acres right on 57. It's gonna be the first thing you see when you're driving into Greenville. You're gonna see City Church as the center of Greenville. We're excited to let the community know that we're putting roots down and we're not going anywhere.
You know, everything we've ever done, we've always done it together. And this project's not gonna be any different. It's gonna be an all in, and we're one great big family, and we're gonna all throw down. I think it's so exciting now that as we've spent many years across the world and spread the gospel to 79 countries, we are now working with all our emphasis in our backyard. All our efforts are gonna be directed on Greenville, Michigan. Did it again. I didn't pray over the offering and never announced that there was. Did somebody take the offering?
Yes.
See, you say I'm all about money. I forget. But either way, I'm not all about money. But I will tell you this. The power of God's grace does flow through green sometimes. And I will tell you, I'm excited about this thing. The way we're going to do this and the way we had to do this, it's kind of interesting. This place is debt free, but to get the money to plant this place, to build this place, we had to put for a year, we had to put a lien on this building again. And we need $3.5 million. We're going to build about a $7 million building for less than five. We got good equity already. As you see the City Church sign there, when that sign went up, it went viral of over 100,000 views. It went crazy. And it's going to be a powerful work of God there, but it's going to take all of us doing it to get it done. And I can't stand having a lien on this building, but the fact that we're so healthy, banks don't even want to work with churches, but they unanimously, just like that, approved working with us. But I want that lien gone, and here's the plan. We're going to have 1,000 units. We need 1,000 people to commit $3,500 in the next 18 months between now and the end of next September in 2025 over the normal amount you tithe. Not your tithe, but your an offering. There's tithes and there's offerings. By the way, the spirit of multiplication of provision is on tithing. The spirit of multiplication is on extravagant giving like that. Some of you, and I got this in the last service but didn't get it, have the gift of giving. 15% of the body of Christ has the gift of giving if you just go by averages. And there are a number of you who have that desire who aren't operating in that gift, but when you step forward and take risks like this, like I'm asking for you, like we're asking for, God will unlock things and elevate you. I can tell you story after story that it's happened. But either way, we're at to have 1,000 increments of $3,500. That boils down to $200 a month over your and my normal giving. We're doing this in the face of inflation when people can barely make ends meet, and we're running right at it. It's like a giant running at a giant with a slingshot. People are going, yeah, build a church in this economy with everything? Yes, we are. We're going to do it. And here's the thing. If we can do that between now and next September, not only will the lien be taken off this, but we'll be debt-free and won't even have a mortgage over there, and we'll be debt-free again, everything up and running. Some of you can maybe pick up multiple units. Some of you who have been really blessed, maybe you can pick up 2 or 3 or 10 or 12. If you want to pick up 20 units or 15 units, call me up if you want more backstory. I'll be happy to spend quality time with you. We are giving you good information, though, but if you want more, I'd be happy to talk with those who would want to even more. But here's the thing. If you have just a little bit and you say, even with faith, I couldn't do a whole unit. You know what? Everything that you give is significant. It takes the widow's mite and the wealthy. It takes all of it to get it done. And you know what happened. You know what happens when a little boy gave his whole lunch. Jesus broke it and said, I can do a lot with this. The little widow woman who was going to starve to death gave her last meal to the prophet. That's all she had. God multiplied it, not only to meet her need, but she stepped into history, and I'm talking about her 2,000 plus years later. So every last gift is important. There's a pledge card like this in your seat pocket in front of you. There's a QR code you can hit on the screen too that will show you more stuff. Like there's virtual drawings of the inside of the church and everything like that. But there's a pledge card here saying if you'll take a unit or a number of units in your commitment. It's all an honor system. We don't follow chasing people down, but it's a faith pledge. And I will tell you that one of the reasons the bank loves us, because when we built this thing, they said between 70 to 80% when there's pledges by a church to commit financially to something, to a project, the average number of pledges that come in churches, with churches doing this, is between 70 and 80%. They said when you guys did pledges, 125% came in, 25% over 100. They were shocked. And so they unanimously approved working with us on this. But I want to be debt free. And if we all throw down on this, it'll be awesome. So, and the bank looks at this too, by the way, all money that comes in, all pledge money that comes in, as it comes in, goes directly against the lien on this place to get it off as fast as possible. And I don't expect it to be on there very long, honestly. So I'm excited about this. Let's all pray about what to do. Karen and I are going to be at the top of the list. We're going to be the first ones to throw down on this from here, and it's important. The Greenville Church needs our help, because the average family income in Rockford is $93,000 a year. The average family income in Greenville is $43,000 a year. That is a lot different. And so they need our help, and we're going to pull together, and it's going to be powerful what happens. I'm excited. By the way, one other thing I should have announced, or Eric Gilmore is going to be preaching here next Sunday. Eric Gilmore has got the goods, I mean to tell you. He got saved under Reinhard Bonnke's ministry, and he has preached regularly in Daniel Kalenda's church, Christ for All Nations, powerhouse. He is doing a conference between 9 and 3 in the afternoon next Saturday at City Impact. And by the way, you can go to our website, and there's a QR code you can hit to buy a ticket. But if you want a spiritual reboot or a reconnect with God to just connect with God in a new level or restore something that's lost or anything like that, go to that thing and soak in God's presence with Eric and the team over there for the day, and some of our team will be over there. But then you will be blessed and find a fresh foothold in the grace of God. But he'll be here next week. Should be a great service. So I'm excited about all of that. Lots of stuff coming down the road. I have an interesting message today. By the way, I'm going to do a podcast middle of the week. There's so much going on in the Middle East and world events that I can't cover it all in this period of time and give messages and everything else. I'm going to do a midweek podcast, maybe live stream, otherwise a podcast. Take about 40 minutes and fill everybody in on what's going on, how it relates to the Bible, how it relates to now, stuff you're not hearing in the news, stuff that's you can encapsulate down into one little body of thing and really have a handle where you have a sense of what's going on. So I'll be doing that as well. And so be looking for that. The information should be online when that will be up and running. Today's message is interesting, and it's still relevant to everything that's going on in the world. And it's called Esther's Challenge. It's kind of interesting. The book of Esther appears in the Old Testament. It's an amazing book. It's with an amazing story. It's got a it's epic. It's got a huge plot where the destiny of a whole people group and nations are at stake. And yet it boils down to the individual performance and at a tipping point with just a couple of people. And it just shows God's amazing control. It shows a plot. It's got an antagonist. It's got a protagonist. It's got key characters. And I'm going to very quickly bring you the story of Esther. It's today's message. It's very unique because it mirrors everything that's happening right now in the world. It concerns the Jewish people. It concerns Iran, who they were captives at in Persia, which is modern-day Iran. And we've got the anti-Semitism at an all-time high as wicked Haman, an Amalekite descendant of Agag, is King Ahasuerus in the king's court, right-hand man, and he plots to kill and exterminate all the Jewish people. And then this story is the same thing is going on today. The same spirits are at work. But I want us to see something amazing in this thing. And I think it's so relative. And it shows how Israel, how the Jewish people escaped destruction through the faith and risk of a few people. And then I want to bring it to our present day. You say, well, why are you talking about all that? What about us? It's real simple. Esther is an Old Testament portrait of the church. Esther is a queen, and so are you. Here's the thing. Her maiden name was Hadassah. Hadassah means myrrh. Myrrh is a leaf from which the most expensive fragrant perfume that existed was extracted, but it was only extracted when the leaf was crushed. And from it comes a fragrance. And remember, myrrh was one of the expensive fragrances that was brought by the Magi to Jesus at his when he was a young boy. But so Hadassah means myrrh, and myrrh is a type of the gospel. And there's a fragrance in the gospel. As Paul writes in the book of Romans, he says this: now thanks be to God, who always causes us to triumph and makes known the sweet aroma of his presence by us in every place. And see, we see Esther as a type of the church in the Old Testament. And the gospel is the fragrance and beauty that comes from us. And of course, she's a Jewish girl. They're in captivity. And there's an event that happens, a fallout. And King Ahasuerus has a queen named Vashti. And he decided, he says, I want your company. And he issued his scepter forward and says, I want Vashti to come to me. And Vashti says, I'm not feeling it. And she says, talk to the hand. And Ahasuerus says, you're done, girl. And out she went. He banished her as queen. Then he said to one of his attendants, he says, gather the most beautiful women in Persia, especially in Shushan, in the capital. And he says, I'm going to pick one of them for my queen. Well, Esther has an uncle named Mordecai. And he says, Esther, you're drop dead. You're runway material, girl. You need to go and apply for that. You're Jewish, and we need someone speaking for us in the inner sanctum. We need somebody representing us. You know, it's crazy around here. Haman's running around wanting to kill us all. You know, we need the help in there. You go do it. And by the way, Mordecai in this story represents the Holy Spirit, the helper who leads and pushes and guides. By the way, the fragrance of the gospel comes, but I forgot to say that. Did you ever feel crushed, pressed, squashed together? As we die to ourselves and go through life's challenges and we keep relying on God's grace, a fragrance rises from our life that affects us and our world of influence. Amen? That's us. So anyhow, she decides to do it. She applies, you know, she just gets her bachelorette clothes together and jumps in the game, and the king picks her. And now she is the queen. She's the queen of Persia with a hidden identity. But of course, there's trouble in the court because wicked Haman, was King Ahasuerus' right-hand man, and he was anti-Semitic. He hated all the Jews in all of Persia, and he talks Ahasuerus into exterminating them all. He says, these people are trouble. They'll rebel against you. Let me kill them all. Now, you have to understand, Haman was an Amalekite. Israel's ancient enemies from way back when they were delivered from Egypt were the Amalekites, but the Agagites were the faction that was radical of the Amalekites, and he was an Agagite, a descendant, a direct descendant of King Agag, who Samuel had killed when Saul wouldn't do it. And so he had it out for the Jewish people who had killed his uncle and his descendants, and he just wanted to kill them all. And he talks them in. So now this edict comes out. All the Jews are going to be exterminated. And Mordecai comes to Esther, and he says, This is what it's all about. This is why you are in the spot. It's time for you to step up, sweetheart, and go out on a limb and save your people. And she goes, hold everything. The last queen, when she came before, when she denied, when the scepter is not held out of favor and you go, you risk death or imprisonment or banishment, one or the other. But because I'm a Jew on top of it, when that's found out, I'm dead meat. I'm done. I'm dead. So he basically asked her, instead of being the royal celebratory queen, to risk her entire life and go to the king on behalf of this people. And she has to step up. She's filled with fear. But this is what he said. Esther 4, verse 12. She said, verse 4, I can't do it. She said to Mordecai, that's my version. I'm going to 13. He sent back his answer and said, do you think because you're in the king's house, you alone of all the Jews will escape? For if you remain silent at this time, relief and deliverance from the Jews will rise from another place. And you and your father's family will perish. And who knows that you have come to your royal position for such a time as this. That's a classic that's echoed down through the ages. That every one of us are key individuals in God's kingdom. All of us are important. And there comes a time when we have to realize our purpose. And he says to Esther, he goes, this is why you were born. This is what it's all about. It's your turn. She risks it all. She takes a huge chance, and she throws herself on the mercy of the king, and the king is furious. And he has Haman hanged on the very gallows he had made for Mordecai. And I'm telling you what, that is just crazy. And by the way, you're going to see that again in modern history. You're going to see the nations and all the plots against Israel. But every nation that ever came, every empire that's ever existed from Egypt on, all the empires, they're dead, they're gone. Their influence is either on the back door or history. But little Israel is frontline news. It's God's postage stamp. It's his. and it will survive everything. And the Jewish people will survive everything. And but she risks it all. And of course, the king can't reverse the law. He can't do it. He made an edict that could not be changed. Well, he makes another one. He says, okay, I can't change that one, but how about this? You guys can take up arms and defend yourself. So all the anti-Semitic crowd came against, on the chosen day, against Israel, but now they're armed with permission, and they went after it, and they had a huge old fight, and they won a great victory. They won their freedom, and they were free, and they called the day Purim, the Feast of Purim that they celebrate to this day. And if you look back at history at all the key things that have happened with Israel and the Jewish people related to the date Purim, just Google it. You'll be pretty surprised. Pretty crazy. So anyhow, this is an amazing, amazing thing. So some lessons for us today. We are Esther. We are the church. And get this. What's at stake? The same old thing. The identity of the Jewish people and their survival and that kingdom. You and I are Esther. We have to stand up for the gospel. The shoe's on the other foot. Do you realize, and I'm getting to everything here today, that the covenants, the law, the prophets, the Bible itself, the Messiah, the church, everything, it all came from the Jews. All of it. And we have a huge debt, Paul says to them. But now this, the shoe's on the other foot. Now they need us. Now the shoe's on the other foot. We need to pray for their deliverance, for their salvation. We need to give. We need to intercede. We need to stand in the gap. We need to pray for our relationship with our country as one nation under God, that we are not separated from those ties. And we need to stand in the gap and pull the rope behind the hedge till all hell breaks loose and the kingdom of God stays firm and solid. And it's up to us to do it. Esther, the church. And so this is really, really crazy. On top of that, there's the mission we have in our own backyard and across the world. The souls of men and women are at stake. Esther has the mandate, the ministry of reconciliation. Jesus, the master craftsman, is building a place for you, and he's praying for you. But you and I are his hands and feet, doing all the work, getting people saved, filled with the Holy Spirit, holding back darkness, being salt, being light. All these things are up to us right now, on whom the ends of the earth, it says, have fallen. And we really are at the end of the end. My podcast, I'll tell you how the chapters of the Bible are right here, right now. Now, here's our lesson. We're on the playing field and it's our time. But even more importantly than that, sooner or later, every one of us has to get up to bat. There's a time it's fun to be in the game. It's fun to be on the team. It's fun to feel all the conflict and play a role. But sooner or later, there comes a key part where we have to pick up a bat and step to the plate and get ready. And what happens in the next moments are all dependent on what we do or don't do. And that's where we are at as a church. That's where the church is at. And it's so, so important. It doesn't matter if we're big and famous or hidden like Esther and Joseph. He was in jail. Oh. Sooner or later, that happens. And you and I, it's on us. When that happens, point number two, it's time to step up and don't shrink back. God's going to get it done either way. You know, each one of us has a purpose. It's absolutely mandatory, and we have to fulfill it. That purpose that each one of us has must be fulfilled for the master craftsman to weave all the threads together. It has to happen. You go, what if I don't do it? Well, it'll still happen. That you don't want to happen. You want your mission, you want your purpose to happen, and you want to be the one that does it, and you want your reward as well. Get this. He talks about, he says, Revelation 3:11, he's talking to the church. He says, hold fast to what you have that nobody can take your crown. He who overcomes, I'll make a pillar in the temple of my God, and he will go out no more. Here's what it says. Each one of you has a crown. Your crown is the royal position along with your kingdom mandate of what to do and what to be. It's all there for you to do and to be. But if you and I, if we don't do it, God will give it to somebody else and it'll still get done. He says, do not let that happen. Do not let that happen. And so I'm telling you what, God called you, he called me, he called city churches, he called us to get something done. And here's the thing, I don't want anybody else to do it, I want us to do it by his grace. Now get this, the key to this, it says he who overcomes. Overcomes what? The world, the flesh, and the devil. Now legally in Christ we've overcome the devil, but we gotta walk it out. We overcome the spirit of this age by marching to a different drummer, the Holy Spirit. And we deny our own flesh, which was born in sin. And it says, I want to sleep in, overeat, lie, steal, do something dumb, do something crazy, be self-centered. And you go, no, you're not going to do that. My body's the temple of the Holy Spirit. You're going to follow the Holy Spirit. You're going to do what I tell you to do that God tells me to do. So you overcome your fleshly desires and have discipline and temperance. And then we rule over this kingdom. We overcome the spirit of this age by marching to the plans of the Holy Spirit. And the devil, in actuality, we walk out what we've already legally experienced in Christ. He says, everybody that overcomes, he says, you're going to be a pillar in my house. You're going to be part of my administration. And when he comes to sweep us away, to rapture us, and he comes back, people don't realize this. It's another story. But there's training in heaven. You think everybody's sitting in heaven playing harps in a crowd? No, they're getting trained on how to rule and reign with Christ in their various roles. And some, of course, will just be royal subjects. But others, they will inherit everything. Because the one who says who overcomes will inherit everything. And when he comes back, we will come back with him. And we, get this, it talks about war with the Lamb, Revelation 17, verse 14. And the Lamb will triumph over them when he comes back, because he's King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. And with him will be his called, chosen, faithful followers. We're going to come back with him in that context, and we're going to rule and reign. So there's three important things we as believers for our mission. Called, chosen, and faithful. Those are the three elements. The Bible says this, many are called, but few are chosen. Everybody gets called, and the Bible says he died for the sins of the whole world. He's willing that nobody should perish. God wants men everywhere, it says, to repent. But only some do. And when they do and say, Jesus, I choose you and your plan for me. I want eternal life. I'm going to be a follower of you. I want your life in me. I'm going to follow you. We move from called to chosen, and we begin to walk and live the life of faith following him. And then lastly, as we walk it out fully, we're called faithful, called, chosen, faithful. Walk it out. It says, work out your salvation with fear and trembling. That doesn't mean I'm scared to death, I'm going to miss it. Nah, it's awesome respect for the presence of the one who lives in you and saved you. And it says this, work hard to make your calling and election sure. Because if you and I do these things, we will never stumble. He's encouraging us to take up our part, our responsibility in the amazing call, the amazing provision. Walk out the plan that's already been pre-planned. Don't let anybody else do it. You do it. We do it. And when that happens, we'll rule and reign with him as called, chosen, and faithful. So, you know, I want to just, as I start to wrap this up, I want to say, don't get caught in the land of excuses. Because every person in this room has been called. Every person online has been called. The majority, if not all of you, have been chosen because you said, I want to be here. I'm in this kingdom. I want to make my mark. I don't want somebody else to do it. I want to challenge some of us to say, don't make any excuses about who you are. While we were singing, I am who you say I am, I am chosen. I am who you say I am, I am who you say I am. I heard someone, maybe more than one person, I heard this voice echoing and think, then why is all hell breaking loose? Why am I going through all this? Why are things not working out? Why don't I believe anymore that I am who you say I am? I don't know if I believe I am who I'm saying I am. I'm a shipwreck in process. And God's saying this, I've allowed the crushing. I've allowed the circumstances. I'm not the author of them, but I'm working in them to change you, to break things in you and to bring things to life through my grace. Also, through all this stuff you're going through that you're looking at as just failure, I'm moving you into exact place that I want you to be for my kingdom purposes. God, don't ever say I'm not who you say I am. Don't ever say I'm not going to accomplish what you've called me to do. Don't make those excuses, because don't look at your circumstances. He's at work in everything, even your multiple trips around the mountain. In all of that, you know what? Someday you'll still learn. And when you do, you'll be patient with a lot of other people who are trying to learn the same way. And you'll have the fortitude and the gratitude in your heart that God didn't cast you out, that he stuck with you. And then you'll extend that same grace to somebody else who needs it. Even your failures all count toward something. I think John Maxwell wrote a book called Failing Your Way to Success. I'm telling you, don't discount God. You are who he says you are. Cast that lie aside. But here, let me give you three excuses real quick here a minute. The first excuse when the bulk of what we want to do, whether it's giving like this project, and we look at our finances or our capability, or some other thing God's called you to do. Maybe he's called you to a public office, to enroll in a school board or a public servant. I got a strong feeling that God wants us to begin in society, many of us, online, in-house, to begin to look, where can I have a godly influence? Whether it's a PTA all the way up to a public servant, to an office, even in the political environment, where can godliness, where can what I do, God, what do you want to do with me? And I'm telling you this, don't make any excuses if there's an unction going on inside you, but step up. Here's the first excuse. Well, who am I? Second excuse, what can I do? You know, and the worst one, I can't. Who am I? God calls Moses on the backside of a desert. He says, deliver Israel. It's a big one, Moses. Moses goes, who am I? And then God goes, who am I? He says, I've called you to do it. And then he says, well, what can I do? I can't do anything. And the same is thing with the widow woman. The widow woman, the prophet gives her the chance of a lifetime, says, give me your last biscuit and some oil and give me your last meal. And she goes, well, why are you picking on me? And what can I do? And I can't, because I'm just going to die after this. Gideon, deliver Israelites. The weak farmer hiding behind the tractor, grinding some thing. It says, in fear and trembling, and God comes and says, I have a huge thing for you to do, you weak-hearted chicken heart. And he goes, he says, who am I? What can I do? I can't. Here's the thing. Here's what's crazy. Is the beautiful thing is all these things and all these men and women, I could give you a dozen more, felt incapable, felt they weren't insignificant. What can I do? And a bunch of them, I can't. And God enabled them all to do amazing, amazing things. And the big I can't, when Moses said, I can't, he says, I can't, I got nothing to work with. God said, yeah, here's my next point. Whatever you have and whoever you are, whatever you have is enough, all you need to get started in everything God wants you to do. It's enough. Moses said, I can't do anything, I got nothing. God said, what do you got in your hand? He says, a shepherd's staff. He says, throw it in the ground. He threw it in the ground, it turned into a snake, big old snake. Ate all the other magicians' snakes. I'm getting hungry, I want a Frosty. You never heard me on sugar. But here's the thing. That rod turned water to blood. It opened the Red Sea. God took that thing that he had and made it a rod of deliverance. You know, the same thing for the widow. What do you got to work with? A biscuit and a little oil? He says, it's enough. I'll multiply it. Put me first. Put it out there. Take a risk. While your little boy looks at you with the last meal, and give it in, and watch what happens in a miracle of provision. And now over 2,000 years later, I'm talking about her. What you and I have is more than enough. From the little boy's lunch to Dorcas's sewing machine. Dorcas just had a sewing machine. It was in her hand. She just started making clothes for little kids. She was such a blessing. The word spread everywhere about her grace. And when she died, she was so important. Peter came and raised her from the dead. What you have in your hand is more than enough. God will empower it. Can you see David with his little slingshot running at that big 9-foot guy? Going like, my God, I hope this works. It's scary. Sometimes putting yourself out there with risk. God will put all of us in places sometime where we'll have to go out so far, we will have to trust him. Some of you, even in regards to giving, I'm telling you, when we started this church, when we started this project up here to get us where we're at and get debt free, way back when we started, God, we threw out a pledge like this, and God led Karen and myself to make a pledge. It was more than I was making that year. It was crazy. And I was scared and a little irritated that I'd even made that. Did you ever do something and wish later, geez, I wish I hadn't have done that. But here's the thing, what happened. We started chipping away at what we had pledged. This is a true story. Chipping away at it. A little here, a little there. And later on that year, an isolated investment I'd made in a small oil company, they hit a big oil field, and the company sold for millions of dollars, and we got a check in the mail for hundreds of thousands of dollars. We were able to pay our pledge and laugh all the way to the bank, and God gave us enough to be able to continue to work and plant this church in a time when we had given up our former careers and income. It was a crazy, crazy thing. I want to challenge you to do something today. I want to just challenge you to pray not only about this, but any area of your life where you feel you God's calling you to step up and step out and serve as a minister, whether you're an usher. Do you realize in the parking lot, we don't even have anybody to work in the parking lot. A parking lot ministry is awesome. You can pray in tongues. You can look for signs of anything that's unhealthy that could come in. You could work in the team and pray for everything that's going on. Or you could give to this project. You could serve. There's so many areas and entry points. What is God challenging you to do? Specifically in this project, but in every area. I want to challenge you, step up to bat. Don't shrink back. Run into the face of fear, because the night's coming when no one can work. If you work hard, don't let anybody take your mission. Do it yourself. And we doing this together, I believe a good year, big year from now, we will see thousands more people as members and parts of City Church. We'll see the grace of God in an area. We'll see his divine protection when pockets of judgment start falling around this nation, because we're the salt of the earth. We're the light of the world, a city set on a hill that can't be hid. It's my prayer that we will do, that we have everything we need in our hands. No excuses. Run for the prize with everything you have. And you know what? Someday soon, the Bible, and this is a big deal, he's coming very, very soon. And we won't be ashamed when he comes back. We won't be. We'll be excited. We'll go, oh, he says, I'll put those who are faithful in charge of everything I own. I want us to be that. Amen? Please bow your heads. If you're here today and you're not right with God, this is a time in human history with the Bible coming true and everything that we see in these shaky times to turn your life over to Jesus and join the unshakable kingdom that will never pass away. He'll give you a new life, a new hope, a new family, a new purpose. He'll turn the light on inside. He'll wipe the guilt from your heart and mind of anything that you've done and give you a brand new start just by asking. He says, if you will confess me with your mouth and believe in me, make a decision to follow me, and pray and ask me, I'll come in. I'll turn the light switch on. I'll wipe away your guilt, give you a brand new start like Barabbas. When he was gonna get crucified that day in agony, heard the guards' footsteps coming down the hall, oh, to the most horrible death, and suddenly the door swung open and they said, Barabbas, somebody took your place. You're free to go. Your slate is clean, and he walked away a free man. God wants to do that for some of you today, here and online. If you're online and you want to pray a prayer that will transform your life, just put your hand over your heart. If you're here, we're not going to call anybody forward, but in a moment, I just want you to lift your hand in a minute, and we're all going to pray together. I won't call you forward, but just do business with God and do not procrastinate. His hand is on some of you here today to change it forever. If that's you, for just a moment, say, Pastor, that's me. I want to get right with God. Just for a moment, put your hand up, put it back down. Put your hand on your heart. He sees every hand and every heart. He sees your hand in here. If I missed it, he sees it. Pray this prayer. We'll all pray it together. Father, I come to you in Jesus' name. Lord, I admit I'm a sinner. I need your grace. I believe you died on the cross for me. You rose again. I ask you into my heart. Forgive my sins. Make me your child. I receive your grace. Thank you for saving me. I will follow you. Lord, I pray for every person who asked you into their heart today. We cancel the enemy's plan for their life. Open up a new living way for them, Lord, and finish the good work you've started in them. Lord, as far as our mission, especially in this next year, I pray that you speak and challenge each one of us by your grace as to what to do, what to our role to play, what our part is. And Lord, we trust you, and we're so grateful that you are using us. You're working with us to build your kingdom, a kingdom that will never pass away. We pray and we ask this in Jesus' name. Everybody said, amen. Give God a hand and thank him for his grace. Let's all stand up. I want the prayer team to come forward. If you have a prayer need, remember, there's a verse in the Bible that says one person can chase 1,000. This is just an allegory, but 1,000. And it says two can chase 10,000. 10 times or 5 times, 10 times the prayer power, just agreeing with somebody about a lost loved one, about a healing, about something you're believing God for. Come on up while we're worshiping. We're going to sing Trust in God. And let's throw our trust in God for our families, for our hope, for our future.
Yeah. And he answered, I sought the Lord, and he heard, and he answered. That's why I trust him, why, that's why I trust him. I sought the Lord, and he heard, and he answered. I sought the Lord.
Presence of God in this place today. It's gonna be awesome. This is gonna be an awesome year. It's gonna be one of the craziest years in the history of the United States. It's gonna be one of the craziest years for City Church. It's gonna be full of excitement, full of faith, full of risk, full of provision. And I'm glad that God decided at the end of the age to pick this group of people, us, to be here. Let's measure up, church. Amen. God bless you. Have an awesome week. You're dismissed. You know, something really cool as we're all leaving. A sister just came up here and accepted the Lord, and she's 96 years old. It's never too late. I love it. I love the grace of God. God bless you. Have an awesome week.
Any answer, I sought the Lord.